Praise the Lord, everyone. Welcome back to another week of Bible study. Praise God. Want to give God thanks for last week. Want to give God thanks for all those who tuned in, those who came on afterwards. So look at the uploaded video. Praise the name of Jesus. And we are always grateful to the Lord for whatever He does to His glory. Amen. Praise God. We just want to make ourselves available to be used by God. Praise God for the glory of His name and the growth of His kingdom. So we are looking at the topic, Fear Thou Not, the voice of calm in the time of storm. And praise God, I don't think we have ever in recent times, certainly not in my memory, have a time more stormy. I mean, I've been through the aftermath of Hurricane Gilbert. I've been through the polio outbreak of the early 1980s. But this is really a trying time. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise God. And we just want to be comforted by the words of God at this time. Before we start, we just like to ask our prayer coordinator from King Street, Sister Paulette Malcolm, to breathe a word of prayer unto God for us. Let us pray.
Oh, Jesus. Lord, we worship You. Lord, we praise You. Lord, we glorify You. Lord, You are the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and the end. You are the first and the last. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your mercy. We thank You for Your love. Thank You one more time, Lord Jesus. Oh God, this afternoon, Lord, as we come before the throne of grace, God, we just want to give You glory. I just want to give You praise, even though, Lord Jesus, oh God, I pray, Lord God Almighty, that You will have mercy upon whom will be merciful and be gracious to whom will be gracious to at this time, Lord Jesus. God, as we come, Lord God, seeking for Your mercy, oh God, I pray You wash me even now, Lord, and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Blot out my transgressions, oh God, creating me a clean heart and renew the right spirit within me. Mighty God, as we come before the throne of grace, even now, Lord, presenting this Bible study, God and Your manservant, Lord, as we come, Lord Jesus, to teach Your word, mighty God. I pray, O God, for all wisdom, knowledge, understanding, Lord Jesus, as we stand before Your people, O God, I pray even now that God will fill His mouth with words, Lord Jesus, through the power of the Holy Ghost, mighty God, as Your word come forth with clarity, Lord Jesus, through this media, mighty God, to Your people. Lord Jesus, I pray even now, Lord, that souls be blessed. Lord Jesus, souls will be strengthened at this time, Jesus. Those who are weak, oh God, will be strengthened, Lord Jesus. Those who are low in the spirit will be empowered, mighty God, through Your word. And so, God, I pray even, oh God, as You touch Minister Manning, Lord Jesus, one more time. Oh God, as He carry out Your work, Lord Jesus. Bless every aspect of this Bible study this afternoon, Lord. Everyone that is watching, oh God, tonight, Lord Jesus, will be blessed, Lord Jesus. Oh God, to You I give glory, to You I give praise, even though, Jesus. Oh God, as we ask of Your mercy, we ask of Your grace, as we leave it everything in Your hands, even though, Jesus, we tell You thanks for what You're about to do, as we ask these mercies in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you very much, Sister Paulette Malcolm. Praise God. We continue the study. Praise God. We had a very good time last week, and we look forward to the Lord being with us, praise God, again this week. Amen. Praise God. So we are at this time, you know, we are restricted. Last week when we were recording, we could have 20 people. Today we are now 10 people in the congregation, but in this family who's watching this, we now have much more than the 10 or even the 20. Praise God, because God has made this possible for us. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Now we continue to implore all those who will be watching this to, praise God, obey the regulation laid down by the authority in terms of the number of persons to congregate and the activities to take to protect ourselves, washing of our hands and the sanitization and so on. And of course, you know, they are now advocating that maybe people should be required to wear masks. So our sister Cassandra has designed a very effective one, praise God. It may not be the N95 or the surgical mask, but it is certainly very good at protecting you, well padded, and will filter out all those viruses that could be in the air. Praise God. So we thank God for inspiring Sister Cassandra to do this. I actually bought 4 for my family. So praise God. I pray that she will do very good business with this. Amen. Praise God. Before we go any further, we want to be blessed by a song of firmer foundation, ye saints of the Lord.
How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have prayed.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord. Praise God. You know, as we're in a time when our elderly are said to be most vulnerable, there is another verse to the song. It was not in the one that we played here, but it said, even in their old age, my people shall prove thy sovereign, boundless, omnipotent love. And when hoary hairs or gray hairs shall their temples adorn, like lamb they shall still in my bosom be born. Praise God. I want to give God thanks for the calming assurance of his words. I want to give God thanks for the fact that even in this time of turmoil, we can look into the word of God and find comfort there. Praise God. So let's go right into that word, the word of comfort. Praise God. Now, as you know, last week we started our focus scripture is Psalms 91, and we are focusing on verses 5 and 6 that said, thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the hour that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. Praise God. We describe the many synonyms for fear. We point out that it has two forms, and it can be a noun or a verb. And we define that as a noun, it meant it has an unpleasant feeling or a feeling of anxiety, an idea or a thought, or anything that causes fright, respect or awe, or concern about something threatening to bring bad news or results. As a verb, we say it's supposed to be frightened of somebody or something, what you call a phobia, or to show respect for or be in awe. And we say that fear can come from a seen or an unseen source, and the nature of fear can be something that we know or something we don't know. Praise God. And so based on verses 5 and 6 of Psalm 91, we were able to categorize it. Anything that they talk about happening in daylight or day or noonday is something you can see, because you can see in light, but anything that's in darkness or midnight, you can't see. Similarly, in terms of things like arrows and pestilence, you know what they are, they are defined, you know what an arrow is, or any other danger, you know what it looks like. The pestilence, whether it be locusts, whether it be viruses, or you know what they look like, you see them on a microscope, but terrors or destruction has no description, has no physical description. They are concepts, or what you call inanimate, praise God. So you really can't touch them, you can't see them, but you can experience them. And we look at the four, therefore, and we number them as they occurred in this text. So number one, terror by night. Number two, arrow by day. Number three, pestilence in darkness. Number four, destruction at noonday. We pointed out that based on how they are placed in the scripture, it would assume that they are placed in order of decreasing importance. But we decided we're going to do them in the opposite order, so that we would be able to leave with our mind on the most important one, the last thing we'll be here with here. So last, we look at the destruction and waste and noonday occurrences, so that natural disasters over which we have no control cannot be accurately predicted, but can have devastating results. But we saw that the Lord promised rebuke the devourer for our sake, praise God. And we sum that up by saying, when life's misfortune arise, we should not be tremble, but trust. Then we look at the pestilence that walks in darkness, praise God. And these are unseen attacks from known sources. Amen. This COVID-19 that we're experiencing is one such. Everybody can, the scientists have now defined the virus, and they can tell you what the structure. They have not yet found a drug to combat it, but we know that the word of God is able to protect us. Amen. So while we can have antidotes against the different things, when it's in darkness, you need light. Praise God. Until somebody was able to describe the novel coronavirus and the structure and so on, they couldn't even begin to look for a cure. Now they can look for a cure because they know what the molecular structure, the cell structure is like and so on. So the best antidote for the pestilence and darkness is light. Praise God. And so we see God advising his people, Joshua in Deuteronomy, praise God, to say that, listen, when you go into the land that I'm going to give you, you're going to drive out the people, but those that hide themselves from you, I will send hornets or wasps among them that they be destroyed. And he said, thou shalt not be affrighted at them, for the Lord thy God is among you. So this week we look at number two in the list in the Bible, number three in our list, the arrow that flies by day. So these are visible attacks from a known source. Amen. So, and they are usually directed against a specific individual or against a church in general. Can range from physical harm to slandering. And we see that in Romans 3 verse 8, Paul said there were slanders reported as saying that let us do evil that good may come. The only way to defeat this kind of attack is by possessing integrity. Because while we cannot always avoid the attack, we can avoid the effect if we ensure that the grounds of the attack are baseless. So let's look at some examples here now. We see the Lord saying to us in Matthew, blessed are you when men shall revile you, persecute you, say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. And Paul put a very interesting footnote to that in 1 Corinthians 15. He said, the sting of death is sin. Now, one of the greatest weapons that Satan has wielded against mankind all the years is death. But the Bible says through death, Jesus defeated him who had the power of death and delivered all them who through all their life have been held in bondage through fear. So once he took this thing out of death, then death no longer had any power. Praise the name of Jesus. Death no longer had any power because you have taken this thing out of it. In St. John 14, when they were coming to arrest him, he said, the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. Praise God. And I'm always reminded of the story of the Trojan horse, where the Trojans were encouraged to bring a wooden horse, into the city. But it had Grecian soldiers hiding inside its hollow stomach. And the night while they were sleeping, the men opened the trap door, the stomach of the horse came out, opened the gates of the city so their soldiers could come in. Well, it's the same thing when we do things that open the doors of our lives to evil, then it can come in. But Jesus said, if they are persecuting and reviling you falsely, so no, he did not promise to deliver us from the arrows, but he assured us that the effects of the arrow will be nullified if the state of our character is right before him. Praise God. And so what we should seek to do is to ensure that we can't stop the arrows from coming. But Jesus said, above all, take the shield of faith, where we shall be able to quench the fiery darts. So he did not promise to stop the darts from being fired, but he gave us a weapon. He gave us an armor that enables us to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. Bless the name of Jesus. And so, for example, when you look at the story of Daniel, even though they were trying to find something to accuse Daniel because of his elevation in Babylon, they said the only occasion they could find against him was to concern the law of his God. Now the thing is, what they were hoping was that when the word went out that nobody should ask any petition of any other God, Daniel would stop praying. Then they could say to him, you see it? It's not genuine. It's not genuine. Praise God. And I know many persons. I remember hearing one person saying that, boy, there was a particular church organization that the minute they started to talk about the corona, closed its door, but still advises his members how to bring their offerings. So they're looking for occasion. In other words, they're saying, oh, all they're interested in is the money. But praise God, we've had services since then, and we don't collect offerings Because you know, the first one we could only have 20 persons. Last week we could only have 10. We are more interested in getting the word of God out. And whatever happens, we are going to be speaking the truth of God. Amen. So Jesus said to them in Luke 12, and he's saying to us today, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed hath brought a cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. And in Matthew 10:20, he actually said, hath power to destroy both body and soul in hell. And so you see the three Hebrew boys in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel saying to King Nebuchadnezzar, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O King. They were confident that Nebuchadnezzar, whatever happened, whether we go in the furnace or not, whether we live or die, we are going to be delivered out of your hand. Praise the name of Jesus. And we know the story well. When they came out of the furnace, Nebuchadnezzar made a decree that in his kingdom, no God should be worshipped except the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were delivered out of his hand. But they said, we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image. So our Christian lifestyle may make men abhor us, may demean us, but that should not bother us as long as it commends us to the Lord Jesus Christ. We are pleasing Jesus, it doesn't matter what men think. Praise God. So even the possibility of death will not shake the believer whose faith is truly anchored in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus told us, some of you shall their cause be put to death, and ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But then he said, very paradoxically, they shall not an hair of your head perish. So even though if they put you to death, not one hair of your head will perish. Every part of you will be delivered into my kingdom. Praise God. So he said, patience possess your souls. He never said possess your life. In fact, in another part, he says, anybody who seeks to lose it, save his life, shall lose it. But whosoever gives your life for his sake and the kingdom save shall find it. Praise God. So Paul said in Acts chapter 20, when he was told how he was going to be imprisoned and so on, he said, none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear to myself. In Philippians, he said, according to my earnest expectation and my hope. You know, one minister Silvanus Frey, defined many years ago, I remember in a Bible study, he said, hope is a confident expectation of a favorable outcome. So Paul said, according to my earnest expectation and my confident expectation of a favorable outcome, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it may be by life or by death. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Bless the name of Jesus. What we should note about the arrow that flieth by day is that we can see it coming. And Paul writes 2 Corinthians 2:11, we are not ignorant of his devices. And while we do not focus on dodging the arrow, we focus on nullifying its effect without being reckless. So we are going to obey the rules that have been laid down to combat this pandemic. We're going to keep the numbers where they say they should be kept. We're going to do all the sanitation and all the social distancing. As long as we don't socially distance ourselves from our Bibles and socially distance ourselves from our prayer. Praise God. We're going to draw closer to Jesus. because Jesus is not afraid of catching anything from us. Praise God. In fact, he cleanses us from all sin. The Bible says we walk in the light as he is in the light. We have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So Jesus doesn't want social distancing. He wants spiritual closeness. But Peter writes, "Beloved, think ye not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you." This is not a pestilence walking in darkness, an arrow flying by day. We know it coming. Praise God. When the church is persecuted, we should know, because Jesus said he shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But Paul writes, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith he shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. The classic example we have there is Nehemiah. While Nehemiah was building the wall and Sanballat and Tobiah was trying their best to stop him, one Shemaiah, the son of Deliah, the son of Mehetabel, invited him, said, "Let us shut the doors of the temple. Let us meet together in the house of God and shut the door of the temple, for they will come to slay thee." Praise God. He was saying that, listen, man, you're in danger. Persons are coming to kill you. Hide and save your life. Nehemiah said, "No, man. Such a man as I flee." Remember, Nehemiah came back from Babylon to come up to rebuild the wall, not to hide in temples. And if he was the foreman on the work, how could he be hiding? How would the work proceed when the senior engineer is hiding in a temple? So he said, "I perceive that God has not sent him." And in verse 30, he said, "Therefore was he hired, that I should be afraid and do so and sin." And I want to say to us, beloved, if we hide from the work of God out of fear for our own lives, we sin. Jesus said, "Anyone who loves his life shall lose it." So Mordecai said to Esther when she refused initially to go to the king, "Don't think that you will escape because you're in the palace. Deliverance and salvation will arise unto Jews from another place, but you and all your house will perish." We should not be afraid for the hour that flies by day. We know the Hamans, we see the gallows, but we're going to strap on our swords of faith. Praise God. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God. We are going to live by the word of the Bible. So our prayer should be, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." So this prayer reminds us that our temptation never comes from God. The temptation always comes from the evil one. God allows it. But the Bible says with the temptation in 1 Corinthians 10:13, he will also make a way of escape that we will be able to bear it. James said, "Let no man say when he's tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." Praise God. Now, some commentators interpret the word evil and say, "Evil one, deliver us from the evil one." But I don't agree with that because of how the sentence is constructed. He said, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." So the word "but" tells us that the action in the second part will be the opposite of the action in the first part. So the first part is about leading into temptation. Do not lead us into temptation. Instead, you're literally going to deliver us out. So just like temptation is not a person, evil is not a person. So it cannot be the evil one. Or we would have to say, "Lead us not to the tempter." I believe that the best expression is to talk about an evil way rather than evil one. And if you look in the Bible, God speaks many times about the evil way. 7 times in the book of Jeremiah, he sends his servant to tell the people to turn from their evil way. The book of Psalms, which I've always said is one of the most theologically rich chapters in the Bible. The writer says, I refrained my feet from every evil way that I might keep his word. Praise God. That's in verse 101. In Proverbs 8 verse 13, the Bible said God hates every evil way. And even the book of Jonah, when the king proclaimed a fast and told the people to put on sackcloth and turn from their evil ways. And the Bible said in verse 10 of chapter 3 in the book of Jonah, that when the Lord saw they turned from their evil way, he spared them. You see, in 1 Kings 13, the Bible talks about King Jeroboam, the evil king of Samaria, who refused to turn from his evil way. So the prayer is, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil way. Make sure our ways are ways that are right in the eyes of God. So the arrow that flieth by day will always fail before the Christ-like lives we live every day as we walk in the righteous way and not the evil way. Praise God. And finally, we touch on the terror by night. And like I said, I left this for last because I want this to be, if everything else is forgotten, this should stick in your minds. Because the terror by night is an unknown, is an invisible danger from an unknown source. You're afraid of, you don't know what, you know not what. And you know not from where, but you're just afraid. Praise God. No, terrors are fears that have no grounding in reality. Persons may be afraid of things that they cannot even describe. And because it takes place in darkness, it's from an unseen, so this is usually a reference to an action in the spirit realm, where the enemy comes and speaks to your mind and cause what the Bible describes as fear or dread. And it's the hardest one to deal with. It originates in your mind, so external help is limited. It takes someone who can live inside of you. That's the Holy Ghost. That's why the word of God, the Bible said, thy words have I hid in my heart. Whatever is going to drive out the terror has to be inside of you. Praise God. So oftentimes the person experiences emotion, is unable to describe it. They cannot say it or understand the reason. And some of these fears can cause normally rational persons to act in an irrational manner. Can prompt persons who are normally strong in their faith to abandon the faith. Praise God. When Peter said to Jesus, Lord, if it be thou, bids me come to thee on the water. Remember, they saw Jesus walking on the water, coming to the boat. And the Lord said, come to Peter, stepped out on the water and started walking. Jesus was still standing on the water, walking on the water. So Peter should have said, okay, he's walking on the water. He has asked me to come to him to walk on the water. I'm walking on water. I can make it. But no, when he saw the winds and the waves around him, praise God. Remember when he stepped out of the ship, the winds were blowing, the waves were there, and he was walking. The Bible said he began to walk on the water to go to Jesus. So it's not like the winds and the waves suddenly sprang up after he started walking. He started walking while they were blowing, while they were heaving, but he lost his focus. And usually what Satan and his angels will do is to tell you, cause it to be there something terrible is going to happen unless you do something. Praise God. And the aim is to encourage the believer to step outside the will of the Lord Jesus Christ by taking matters into his or her own hand. Praise God. And we hear the expression very regularly, God help those who help themselves. That's not in the Bible, folks. God help those who trust in him. Praise God. And the Bible is full of examples of persons who decide to take matter into their own hand because they feared the consequences. Abraham, the father of the faith, denied or declined to acknowledge Sarah as his wife because he was fearful for his life. The Bible said God had said unto Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, get out of thy from among thy kindred and thy father's house and go to a land that I will give thee. But when Abraham got down to the land that God said he was going to give him, he began to fear the people who lived there. When God promised him a son, the Bible said Abraham believed God and God counted to him for righteousness. But when a few years passed and no son was forthcoming, he committed adultery with Hagar, his wife's handmaid, because he believed God would not give him any children unless he did something. When Isaac was afraid about his wife, about his life, because his wife was so good looking, he thought the people would murder him to get his wife. He lied that Rebecca was his sister. Praise God. In 1 Samuel 13, King Saul was told by Samuel to wait at Gilgal until he got there. But after a time, Saul became fearful. What if Samuel don't come? What if the people lead me? What if, what if, what if? And so he decided to take on the role of a priest. This man from the tribe of Benjamin was taking on a role that belonged to the children of the tribe of Levi, because he was afraid. Aaron, the man who stood beside Moses 10 times before Pharaoh and saw the mighty miracles that God did when Moses went up into the mountain to receive the oracles, Aaron became afraid. As for this Moses, we don't know what has become of him. And Aaron, the Lord's priest, the high priest in Exodus chapter 32, made a golden calf. And when he presented it to the Israelites, said, these be thy gods, O Israel, who have brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Look at Job, David's faithful soldier. But after Saul was dead, David was established. Abner, Saul's former general, came to make peace with David. Job thought he was a spy. I wonder if they're going to come to run David off the throne again. I wonder if he's going to be hiding again. I wonder if. And so Job killed Abner. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. And so you see the terror by night, the morbid fears of persons who think, boy, something bad is going to happen. We have to do something about this. We have to fix this somehow. We have to make the necessary steps. And oftentimes, in fact, most of the time, in fact, I would say all the time, when we decide to take things into our own hands, we always end up making the situation worse than it ought to be. We always end up in a situation where the God we are trying to help has to now come and deliver us from our own foolishness. Praise the name of Jesus. Bless the name of the Lord. The only way to completely empty the mind of terror is to fill it with assurance. It's like a cup. If it's full of air, the only way to drive out the air is to pour in water. And once it's full of water, you can be assured all the air is gone. No, we cannot fight against. We said what happened in darkness is what happens in the spiritual realm. So we cannot fight against a spirit with human weapons. And so we see the psychologists and the psychiatrists come on all these things, and they'll have fancy names for them. Praise God. But sometimes they only make matters worse. One of the things that come readily to mind is this thing, the so-called sickness they call ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Children who are naturally full of a lot of energy, high metabolism, and just want to keep going. They can't sit still. And if you put them to sit, they want to, they'll turn the chairs upside down and sit on the legs. If you give them a chance. Natural actions, but all of a sudden they come up with a name. And then you'll find that millions of children are injected with all kinds of drugs and tranquilizers while they are still young. And then we wonder why they grow up to become maladjusted adults. Because man is trying to fix a problem that he thinks exists. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Trying to and making it worse. God's solution is simple. Keep your heart and your mind fixed on me, and I will deal with the problem. Praise God. Praise God. So Jehoshaphat was confronted with a large army in 2 Chronicles 20. And in verse 12, he goes to God in prayer. He said, we have no might against this great company that cometh against us. Neither know we what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. Jehoshaphat is saying that they are out there. They are jeering us. They are trying to make us afraid. The man has sent a letter telling us what he's going to do, and if we don't do so and so, if you don't come and do so, if you don't give me so and so, I'm going to come and do so and so. And Jehoshaphat said, okay, they've sent me, they want me to click on this link. They want me to turn away from you. One of the king, when he saw an army, he sent down, the king of Samaria sent down to Egypt. And God said, is it because there that a God in Israel? Why you have sent down to Egypt? Jehoshaphat went to God. And the story we know well. God said, just assemble your singers and start sing. And let me fight the battle. In Psalm 32, he assures us, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. Be ye not as the horse or the mule which have no understanding. Let me tell you something, folks. When we start to run up and down and believe everything we see on the internet about COVID-19, and we spend more time surfing than praying, when every little video that comes out, because I've seen videos sent to me, one video that is saying it's caused by radiation from what's it called, 5G technology. Another video is saying it's a virus that was developed by the Americans to nullify the Chinese economic rise. Another one says a virus that was being developed by the Chinese and it got out of hand. There are all kind of theories. But I don't rest in theories. I rest in assurances. God has promised me. Praise God. He said, I am Jehovah Rapha. I am the God that heals you. Bless the name of Jesus. And just like those Hebrew boys, I'm saying, you are able to deliver me and my family from COVID-19. But if you don't deliver us, we are not going to lose our faith in you. In verse 10 of Psalm 32, he said, many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. And one of the
contrast you want to see between Jehoshaphat and Hezekiah. If you read 2 Kings 18 verse 14 to chapter 19 verse 30, when the king of Assyria came to Hezekiah, Hezekiah took all the silver that he had and even took the golden doorknobs of the temple of God to send to appease the king. And the king was still determined to invade. And it was not until Hezekiah went to God in prayer and say, you see how the man is repaying us after all we've done? And God intervened. Our first turn. The Bible says, whenever I'm at whatever time I'm afraid, I will trust in thee. Another one said, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord which made heaven and earth. The terror by night will not be changed are assuaged by the assurances of men, but the promises in the word of God are, the Bible says, the word of God are quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Isaiah said, thou wilt keep me in perfect peace with mine is still on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Trust in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. In Proverbs, Solomon said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lead not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Don't try to find your own solution. Many times persons, when they fear, they pray a couple times and God doesn't answer right away, then they try to find another way, another solution. He said, fear the Lord and depart from evil. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed but abideth forever. Praise the name of Jesus. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people. And listen to this, from henceforth, even forever, from this time until eternity. So whenever you read this, no matter how you felt before, whenever you read this, understand that God is around you from now going forward. Because he has promised, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. We saw and heard in the song, he said, the soul who on Jesus has leaned for repose, he will not desert to his foes. The rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hands to iniquity. In St. John 14, he promised the comfort of the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things, bring to your remembrance what I said. Then he said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. We are not waiting for world leaders to assure us that COVID-19 is under control for us to feel secure. We are saying, God, you are our refuge and strength, and ever present, very present, a certainly present help in trouble. Praise God. So Paul writes, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. The peace of God. And so finally, brethren, as we come to the end of this two-week Bible study, finally, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. As I said earlier, as a child, I used to sit and wonder if I could think of nothing. But then I found myself thinking of how I was thinking of nothing. So Paul said, you can't just sit down and try not to think about what's happening, because you're going to think about how you're not thinking about what's happening. Fill your mind with thoughts of God. What I've done to help me remember this scripture is a little acronym Praise God. Our mnemonic, it's called. We talk about what is true, honest, just, pure, lovely, and good report. And I put that in a sentence, that the hope of Jesus' people is to live godly. THJPLG. And I find I can remember Philippians 3:8 very well. Praise God. And you have my permission if you want to use this or you want to create your own. These are the things that, tools that we can use to remember the promises of God. And finally, I want to say to you, Proverbs 29, verse 25. The fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be saved. Shall be saved. Where is your trust today? Is your trust in the scientists who are searching for a solution for COVID-19? Or is your trust in the Lord? You know, today I heard on the news that in Britain, they are moving to the point where they can test 100,000 persons per day. Now we may say, wow, that's a whole lot. But in a country of 63 million people, 100,000 is going to take you 630 days. That's 2 years, almost. Can we afford to wait 2 years before we feel safe? I say no. We can feel safe now if we put our trust in the Lord and fear not. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time we have spent studying your word. We pray that your peace, which passes human understanding, will settle in our hearts and our minds right now. While we are not going to be reckless concerning the medical challenges that our country is facing, we are going to do our part, but first and foremost, we are going to trust in you. We are going to lean on your word. We are going to pray for your guidance, your covering, and your deliverance. I pray for your people, those who will watch this video, and those who maybe through it, oh God, will find cause to come closer to you. And I say, let your will be done in Jesus' name. Praise God. So as we close, I'd like to leave you with the sound of the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. I am not afraid.
From the love.